Davies, and I'm on all the posters as being the chairman of this event. Unfortunately, I've been ill, and I apologize for not attending the rest of the forum. And I have to thank my colleague, John Martin, who agreed to take over the chair in the very likely event I wouldn't have been here. So I am here, but John is going to chair the event. Thank you.
So I would like to start this fourth Wrocław debate on a very important topic, education. Now, Norman Davies has just said that I will chair instead of him. And when I was in the bookshop in the main square in Wrocław this morning, I went into the Norman Davies section of the bookshop, and I thought, golly, I'm chairing this afternoon. It's a little bit like being asked to stand in for Nelson just before the Battle of Trafalgar. But I'll do my best. This debate will be, first of all, a discussion, a series of statements. First of all, by Professor Chris Hubbard, Director of UCL Institute of Education and Vice-Provost for Academic Development at UCL. Chris, there. Secondly, by Mateusz Mazzini, who's the editor of Politica Insight. Over there. Then thirdly, Norman Davies will speak. I don't know to introduce him. And then thirdly, I will finish the series of four statements, and I'm Professor of Medicine at University College London, an adjunct professor of medicine in Yale University in the United States. Then we will have an interaction with the audience that I will chair, and I hope that you will vigorously take part in that. Even if you don't like what we're saying, you can say stop, and we'll stop the thing and you can object, okay? Please try and do that. Now, the theme of this year's Wrocław Forum has been Russia and the relationship of Europe to Russia in a transatlantic scenario. Anna Palacio yesterday impressed me very much. Anna is the former foreign minister of Spain, very well respected. And the panel was saying, why is Russia dividing us? Why cannot the European Union stick together and have a common strategy towards Russia? And Anna Palacio said, because we have lost a unifying idea in Europe. And I was very impressed by that. I believe that Europe has lost its noble purpose. One of the things I think we'll be questioning now is the role of European education, not in education per se, but as a major actor in developing the future of Europe. So, first of all, I'd like to invite Chris Hubbard to come and talk to us.
Thank you very much. So, good afternoon, everybody. It's an enormous pleasure and privilege to be here. A lot of what I'm going to be saying in the next 15 minutes or so is about international comparisons in and about education. And I get to talk to lots of audiences all over the world, and I notice huge differences between them. But I notice one thing that is a constant, which is that nobody ever wants to sit on the front row. And the front row is indeed completely empty. So if you are sitting further back and I can persuade you to come to the front, nothing bad will happen to you if you sit on the front row. So if you would like to come forward, please, please do. The exam question, the debate question that we've all been set is European education fit for purpose? And it's one of those questions, isn't it, which it's almost impossible to give the answer yes to. It's a question that invites debate and it invites criticism. And around the world, as we become increasingly interested in global comparisons of education system performance, we look at the effective systems of the Pacific Rim and scratch our heads and wonder whether there is something wrong in Europe. And I want to spin off a few series of reflections from that to get the debate going. There is a consensus. There is a consensus around the world about the massive importance of education. The mantra goes a bit like this, I think. The 18th century economy was an economy powered by steam. The 19th century economy was an economy powered by coal. The 20th century economy is an economy powered by oil. And the assumption is that it is skill and the returns to skill and investment in education which will drive the 21st century economy. What that means is that around the world, countries are reforming their education systems at a pace. The OECD 2015 Education Policy Outlook report compares the efficacy of 480 education reform programs across the OECD countries. The assumption is that the 21st century is an economy where, sorry, in the 21st century economy, education constitutes the magic bullet. The enormously influential piece of work of the last 15 years, work by Claudia Goldin and Lawrence Katz, The Race Between Education and Technology, advances the argument that the 20th century was the American century because for the majority of the century, up until the middle of the 1970s, education attainment in America rose, and it rose on the back of pretty egalitarian investment in education. And if I were reliant on my usual PowerPoint presentations, I've got a wonderful slide which simply says, education, the next best thing to a record deal. But, it's not as simple as that. If it's impossible to give the answer yes to the question, is European education fit for purpose, that is partly because I think there are three quite different things that we could talk about when we talk about education. For all the international comparisons, education is highly culturally specific. My own university, my own institute, the Institute of Education, University College London, is currently doing a very big piece of work with the government of Kazakhstan on curriculum reform, and we've been working through the mathematics textbooks for primary education in Kazakhstan. And you think mathematics, culturally invariant, 2 + 2 always equals 4. But once you get beyond basic numeracy, it turns out that mathematical concepts are rendered very differently in Kazakh and English. And I'm not enough of a mathematician to explain it, but the way in which proportion is dealt with is handled fundamentally different. So, when we're comparing education systems, I think we're comparing some quite different things. And I want to just outline three different ways of thinking about educational effectiveness. We can think about the education system as a set of institutions, the kindergartens, the schools, the colleges, the universities, the formal institutions which shape public policy in education, the institutions for which governments are responsible, whose performance by and large keeps ministers awake at night. And we can make comparisons between the outcomes of those systems. They can be productive or they can be unproductive comparisons. But the institutional framework is not the whole of education. A second way of thinking about education is not simply in terms of the institutional framework, not simply in terms of the schools and the colleges and the universities, but also in terms of the extra institutional investment that is made in education. The spending on education that goes on outside schools and colleges and universities. That may be discretionary spend. It's spending on additional cultural activities for children and young people. 80% of young people in Korea receive private tuition of one sort or another. The most intensive study of this activity in the United States suggests that between 1970 and 2005, the amount of discretionary spend invested by the top quintile, socioeconomic quintile of the population, increased sixfold in real terms, whilst the spend of the lowest quintile remained the same. So if we want to think about education, we're thinking about non-institutional investment as much as we're thinking about institutional investment. And there's a third way of looking at education, which is not in terms of the institutions or the discretionary spend, but the cultural part that education plays in different countries, in different ways, in different cultures. The very high status accorded to teachers in the Jewish tradition, in the East Asian tradition. Something that impacts powerfully on the ability of institutional frameworks to recruit, to retain, and to deploy teachers. So it's really hard to answer the question as to whether European education is fit for purpose, because it depends which of those lenses we want to explore it through. Through the institutional framework, through the sorts of non-institutional spend that is made in education, or the cultural significance of education in different settings. And that means that arguably there is no such thing as a European education model. That those things that I've just described, the institutional framework, the extra-institutional investment, the cultural shape, look very different when viewed from Helsinki, from Madrid, from Kiev, from Paris, from London. I do think, however, that there are comparisons that we can make that determine the extent to which education is indeed fit for purpose, and which have the potential to take forward education and to realise its potential in this 21st century. And I'm going to distinguish four things that for me underpin a highly effective education system. The first is a genuine commitment to realising education for all. European education systems were extremely effective in the pre-modern era in educating the elite. The difficult task for the 21st century is to deliver high-quality education for all. Secondly, to recognise that just as most education systems in most eras have been a read-off from the requirements of the economy, so what drives the 21st century economy, the significance of a knowledge economy, of innovation, of development, means that education, through its curricula, assessment, and accountability arrangements, needs to drive innovation as much as stability. Thirdly, to accept that in societies which are becoming ever more diverse, publicly funded education is something, it's one of the few things, that drives a common experience for all young people. And that education plays a critical part, not only in state formation, but in social cohesion and moulding a common shared culture. It is a glue that holds diverse societies together. And fourthly, at the same time, to recognise that the interdependence of the world in which we live, and which has shaped so many of the discussions at the forum over the last 2 days, means that education not only needs to be nationally rooted, but driven by a sense of a global citizenship, of global engagement, that what happens in Ukraine today impacts sharply on London tomorrow. So those four things, education for all, education for innovation, education for social cohesion, education for global citizenship, are the four things that, for me, define the characteristics of an education system, however conceived, which is fit for purpose. And if I can end my comments with one mild criticism of this forum, and I know that's very rude, I only arrived recently, it is to note the relative invisibility of education amongst those here present. Ministers, businessmen, policymakers, very important. But if I'm right that education is the next best thing to a record deal, if its role in innovation, cohesion, and global citizenship is critical, then education needs to be a loud voice in forums such as this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chris. Excellent. And can I echo what you said? We were just talking about this before we started. If the Atlantic Forum is going to see transatlanticness in relation to strategy and policy in the most global way possible, then I believe that the university has to be represented here. Otherwise, the policymakers are losing an important focus. So, our next speaker is Mateusz Mazzini. Mateusz.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Professor Martin. Thank you, John, for that fantastic introduction to our debate today. And first and foremost, I feel like I'm obliged to say that it's my utmost pleasure and a great honor to be invited to take part in such an amazing debate, which is part of an even bigger and even more impressive Wroclaw Global Forum. And once we were hearing all those fantastic definitions and concepts about education that John was providing us with, I feel that there's a little bit more to add, because my Oxford experience taught me that once you approach an exam question, the very, very first thing one needs to do is to unpack all the critical elements of the question before thinking how to answer it. And once John was speaking about what is education, how we can perceive education through different lenses and through different optics and its different roles in society, I think because our question asks, is European education fit for purpose? One of those questions that need to be asked in advance is, what kind of purpose are we speaking of? Or whether is there a purpose that could be universally applicable for all European education systems? And eventually, the very question, is there such a thing like European education? And I'm proud and simultaneously very happy to somehow be able and prove myself that there is something like European education. In fact, I consider myself a product of European education, having undertaken education on various levels and various means of experience in five different European countries. And if I was to say or characterize the European education versus the North American one, I would say that with one word, the American one is characterized by choice, whereas European one is characterized by foundation. And what we all share in common, independent of whether we're kids that went to school in Madrid, Milan, Stockholm, Warsaw, or Bratislava, is that we have gone through significantly similar concepts of education in our early years, in year one, year two, year three of our education. However, this is not really where I wanted to put my emphasis on in this speech. John, speaking before me, said about three different lenses, or three different types of optics that we can use to scan European education. I wanted to speak about three different roles, or call it purposes, if it pleases you more, that could be defined as three F words. And I want you to remember those three F words, because they're going to be a perennial theme of this speech and hopefully of the debate that follows. I think that if there is one purpose that European education could be characterized by, it could be decomposed into flexibility, freedom, and fantasy. And here, the flexibility, I see it as the flexibility of management and the flexibility of how to deal with trouble. The freedom is the freedom of choice on how to teach, what to teach, and how to teach to become successful. Whereas the third is the fantasy of teaching about life. Because one of the underlying assumptions of my understanding of the question whether European education is fit for purpose is that education needs to be adaptive to the purpose of society. In other words, education follows, or should follow, changes that we undertake as group of citizens. There's a wide assumption in the field of policymaking in education, or studying education, that education is a notion that mirrors or reflects the development, historical troubles, and historical processes of the society in which a given system is placed. And there's an amazing book by James Robinson and Darren Aksamoglu, two scholars from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which I recommend to everyone that's interested in the topic, which is entitled Why Nations Fail. And even though, to make the long story short, the book talks about economics and good governance and state formation, there's surprisingly loads of different chapters dedicated to education. Because education is important, and education is a tool of state building. And once we all, including those who are in position of influence, understand that it is, in fact, a state building and a society enforcing tool, there is a way forward for us to have a purpose of society to which the education can contribute. And as I said before, the very first F word that I wanted to somehow decompose and to talk to you about is the flexibility of management in various educational units. But first and foremost, the flexibility to deal with trouble. Because one of the very important features of our education here in Europe, and we can broadly speak that more or less, we don't really differ on that ground, is the universal applicability and availability of education. But one of the warring tendencies that many countries, including Poland, including Italy, which are the two countries I happen to know most of, have been undertaking in recent years, is a progressive cancer of centralizations of decision-making in education. In other words, we tend to establish central institutions that are sharing enormous powers on paper. But then we tend to forget that even though we might apply universal measures, there will be places in our countries, there will be schools in our regions that, because of the context of where they placed, of where they come from, and because of what kind of experience has the local population gone through, will be different. And as Jun was saying before, teaching even a science as universal as mathematics in Kazakhstan be much different to what it feels like in Boston or London. And one of the problems that we happen to be confronting is that we tend to apply universal measures and universal quantifiers of success and failure to all of our units, forgetting about the context. And if I was to recommend any kind of policy solutions for anyone that happens to be in charge of dealing with education if in their respective countries was to not to be afraid of taking a step forward towards decentralization. Decentralization and allowing of more freedom in managing schools, managing universities, and managing other educational units. Because troubles differ and successes differ. And applying universal measures to solve same problems doesn't really work out in many European countries. And as Neil Ferguson, the renowned scholar of public policy and public economics, has written in one of his most flagship books, The Great Degeneration, he claims that one of the degenerations of our times is the degeneration of forgetting that schools differ. And he proposes a decentralization and something that Brits call the evolution of academias, the change of public schools into academias that then become independent and are units that are somehow managed on their own. It might not work out in all the countries, because in as much as we like to think about Europe as a coherent organism, we differ, but it's certainly an experiment worth having a look at. The other F word that I've mentioned at the very, very beginning of that speech is the freedom of choice. And as I said before, choice is perhaps something that comes to one's mind more often when speaking about the education in the United States, because we're very used to that notion of college students doing a various curriculum at the college stage, and then at the age of 21, 22, oftentimes later, only deciding to what's most important for them. Whereas Europe doesn't allow for that much of freedom. European education makes you make up your mind much sooner than the Americans do. And it has its pros and cons, its benefits and drawbacks. We tend to be told to specialize much sooner, which is good when we know that we want to specialize in something that we end up in. But there's a worrying process, which I feel deserves a bit of recognition and a bit of red alert, that we seem to be turning our educational institutions into money-making processes that are supposed to respond to the challenges of the market to a much greater degree than they're supposed to reflect the processes in our society. And that's one of the processes which deserves a voice and a public hearing. And I was very pleased to observe the most recent actions that took place in Warsaw, when the students of the so-called engaged university, the Università Zaangażowana, took on the streets, went out and said that academia, or broadly speaking here, education deserves a voice. Because I was very pleased to listen to the digital panel this morning, which I believe many of you have attended, and to hear on behalf of Agata Wacławik from Google Poland that Google is investing into so much entrepreneurial toolkit, and it's fostering the development of startups through setting up the Google campus, which is all magnificent. But we need to forget to remember, and we cannot forget, that those entrepreneurial startup people won't come from nowhere. They need to be first educated. And that's a passage to the third F word that I want to talk about, which is the fantasy of teaching about life. Because life is changing in as much as the society is changing. And the life aspirations and life goals of our generation differ much from what our parents could have even imagined or dreamt of. And so needs to education follow and respond to that challenges. And if we happen to live in a world that gets digital more and more with every single day, we need to have our education having the proper tools and being able to adapt us to the evolving society. And I swear to you, in as much as it sounds controversial, there won't be any successful startup people at the future Google Poland campus if we won't start to teach them how to become entrepreneurial in their own schools. And there won't be many Mars missions coming from Poland, Italy, Bosnia and Herzegovina, or Germany if we don't tell our kids that building up a robot doesn't necessarily have to be a rocket science task. Because education has a very important role to play in society, especially in times as turbulent and as dynamic as those as we live in. Because even if there is one science, and I think that most of the scientists agree that there is one science, there are many different educations. As there are many different societies, often determined by their own context. And here, I think I might say something that will raise a wave of controversies, because it's a statement that I know for a fact many of Polish renowned scholars disagree with. But I say that not everything that Warsaw, Kiev, or Bratislava adopts from Boston, Los Angeles, or Edinburgh will be perfect, inasmuch as not everything that those countries inherited from the post-Soviet educational system is necessarily bad. And it's time for us to look beyond those little, tiny categories of perceiving education. I think it's time to see that there are aspects of our own educational systems that we can adopt into that future, more dynamic, more digital agenda and more digital curricula for our students. And one of those things, just to give you an example, is the universal access for education and the relatively high level of basic education that Poland and many other countries inherited from the Soviet times, which, for those who had the opportunity to study in most of the Anglo-Saxon countries, doesn't necessarily happens to be the case all the time. And as we heard in John's speech, and as I said before, there's one science, and there's one role, one key role that education should play in society, is to reflect the changes, to respond to the changes, and to contribute to the development of both society and state and its institutions. But in order to make that happen, education needs to have a voice. And there's a magnificent, magnificent film scene in The King's Speech where Geoffrey Rush sits down on the throne of the English king, and then Colin Firth, looks at him and says that he doesn't have the right to sit there. And Geoffrey Rush asks him, "Why should I waste my time listening to you?" And then Colin responds by saying, "Because I have a voice." And that is what education is at the moment. Education seems to be that king which is deprived of its throne and is deprived of its voice. And if I was to put two messages to conclude my speech, one would be to the education people that you have a voice, that you have your place in the streets, that you have your place in the parliaments, you have your place on your universities, and don't let yourself be put down by any notions of numbers, of money, of corporations, and of turning your entities into a universal cell of a much bigger machine. The second one, to conclude, would be a message to policymakers. Be interested in education, because education is like climate change. You might not be interested in it, but education is most certainly interested in you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mateusz. Lots to discuss there. I don't agree with your thesis that education should reflect society. It sounds to me very Marxist. I know you won't like me saying that to you. Secondly, I'm very skeptical about digital education. depends what education is. And I noticed that Chris didn't define what education is when he was talking
about that.
And perhaps we can discuss that later. I won't talk about it now, but I'm very frightened about the digital world and the creation of new idea in education. Perhaps we could discuss that from the floor. Now, it's my great pleasure to invite the local hero to come and talk to us, Norman Davies.
Thank you, John, for that very brief introduction. I'm very relieved to see that none of my colleagues have thought to mention some of the points that I have on my list, so I won't at least be repeating what's already been said. A very good colleague of mine from Oxford, Professor Jan Zielonka, who was born and raised in this city and who took part in our debates a couple of years ago, recently published a book entitled Is the European Union Doomed? Czy Unia Europejska jest skazana na śmierć? A more drastic title, it would be hard to imagine. Yet the mood is bad and the prognosis gloomy. What is more, criticisms are now coming not just from the Euro haters, but from pro-Europeans who sympathize with the Union's aims and wish it well, but who often fear for the worst. Today's topic, therefore, should be put, I think, into this context. The question would then become, is education, or rather the failings of education, in some way one of the underlying elements of the Union's distress? I myself have been involved in education all my life, both as a child in an education-minded family, as a schoolboy and student, as a schoolmaster, then a university teacher, and more lately as a writer. And I obviously believe that no organization, no society can flourish if the people that belong to it have not been well and appropriately educated. The key word, I think, would be appropriately. The European fathers and their successors, for 60 years and more, have been pressing ambitiously for ever closer union. It strikes me as odd, therefore, that none of them thought fit to design a European education system. For believe it or not, no such system exists. Education is one of the areas that was reserved for the control of member states. So what we have is 30 or 40 self-regulating national or provincial systems, over which the European Commission and its Directorate General for Education and Culture has nothing more than a supportive role. What supportive actually means is anybody's guess. Alongside this cacophony of systems, a multiplicity of lobbyists, pressure groups and NGOs has grown up, each with its own special interests and priorities. The net result is a superabundance of plans, schemes and theories, which no doubt make a very good living for the university institutes that study them. but which do not make for coherent progress in any particular direction. 50 years ago, as I remember, I myself joined one such pressure group called the European Studies Association, which, perhaps as a sign of the times, has since ceased to function. My third general point would stress the fact that this mass of European educational systems is hugely diverse. Some of them, by world rankings, are very good. 12 of the top 20 are European, although Japan, South Korea, and Singapore usually seem to rule the roost. Europe's own top five are the United Kingdom, Russia, Finland, the Netherlands, and the Republic of Ireland. At the same time, Europe's backmarkers, Slovakia, Hungary, Latvia, Romania, and Ukraine, linger at or near third world levels. Poland, incidentally, is high on the list, ranked number 16, 2014. Huge variations, of course, seem to call for urgent remedial action. But by whom? What I now intend to do is to produce a quick checklist of issues that are central to this general question of the type of education most relevant to the needs of the European Union and its 500 million plus citizens. Those needs are surely not identical to those of nation states, even though all European Union citizens are simultaneously citizens of the member states. What we are talking about is adding a European dimension and providing a stronger European focus to existing systems. No one, I think, is contemplating tearing up what exists, root and branch. Or perhaps John is, I don't know, I'm waiting for his bombshell. No one, as far as I know, is contemplating tearing up what exists, root and branch, or of imposing some centralized directive system from above. Needless to say, each of the following issues that I've identified deserves an hour's lecture for itself. All I can do is to throw out some items for discussion. Number one is education in the humanities. I've read that 50% of all cuts in European educational budgets in the last 5 years have fallen on the teaching of the humanities, meaning the classics, language and literature, history, philosophy, art, music, and so on. I.e., the cuts have fallen on the very subjects that are most open to a European dimension. It's perfectly possible, of course, to present the humanities in a very narrow, nationalistic, patriotic framework. But given the wider approach, they are the vehicles that can lead to an understanding of our European heritage. It's a sad day, I think, if the humanities are to be downgraded and preference given to science and technology, to IT, to the digital world, and to the mumbo-jumbo of economics. Number two is pan-European civic education. This is an issue backed, for instance, by the European Civic Education Foundation, which presses for the adoption of courses on the origins of the European movement, on the outlines of European institutions, and on the study of pan-European topics. It is not a question of either and or, either traditional national civics or European civics. It insists on a balanced combination of both. I fear that it's not very well developed in the United Kingdom, and it may be why Eurosceptic attitudes have been boosted there in recent years. Number three on my list is multilingualism. I was surprised and pleased to learn the other day that 54% of European Union citizens, a clear majority, are already bilingual. That is, they can conduct a proficient conversation in at least two languages. Even more surprisingly, 25%, or one quarter, are trilingual, and 10% quadrilingual or higher. Yet many problems remain. Language teaching is declining exactly in those places where it is most needed, like the United Kingdom or in Ireland. And no consensus exists on questions such as the choice of the third language or the role of non-international European languages like Polish, Italian, or Finnish, and so on. That's one for you. To whom, other than Poles, should the Polish language be taught? You can't teach everything to everybody. My fourth item is about European studies. In the last 20 years, a new interdisciplinary subject called European Studies has grown up in universities on both sides of the Atlantic. To my mind, a promising development. But the content of those studies gives rise for concern. It remains overwhelmingly West European. French, German, Spanish, Italian, and gives no space or very little space to the largest parts of our continent. Poland, for example, has been a member of the European Union for a dozen years, but to my knowledge, no single European studies course in the United Kingdom contains a single module or segment about modern Poland, or of any of the other accession countries. Point number five is history, and I must restrain myself from going on at length, because it's the largest of all subjects, which includes all the others, and it's always subject to very severe selection. I myself have been in the forefront of campaigns to make European history more inclusive. But here I take a different tack. A quick word about museums, because museums are one of the institutions of education. Every single European country has its national museum or museums present and funded to exhibit its national story. Yet so far, no satisfactory museum of European history has seen the light of day. No less than three attempts have been made by organs of the European Union to create a European museum, and it is only next year that the European Parliament's House of History will open its doors. Even so, there are many strident voices prepared to call this lone European museum a vanity project or a waste of money. In conclusion, while falling short of calling European education a basket case, I do believe that it faces a severe uphill struggle. And if pushed up hard against the wall on the wording of today's debate, I would have to say, no, as things stand, European education is not fit for purpose. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Norman. Lots to discuss there. Why don't we have a pan-European educational system? Also, just to support you with languages and humanities, I think the only reason I've been successful as an academic doctor and a scientist is because I studied philosophy before medicine, and I speak five languages. And I'm very much aware that my success in science is based upon my humanities base in my own education. One thing I forgot at the beginning was to thank the Lord Mayor of Wrocław, who was always very supportive for this debate and is also normally a very vigorous contributor. So, Chris, will you chair me? Chairman should not speak without being chaired. If I go over, will you raise the alarm bell?
I will, yes.
Okay, good. So I believe that European education is not fit for purpose. We have to define what is purpose, what is education, and what is fit. Well, let's leave that to the debate. I think going back to Anna Palacio yesterday in the debate on Russia, we have not got a noble purpose. We used to have one, and that has been lost. Well, I think I got my noble purpose with my mother's milk, but that was enhanced by my education. A major problem in the United Kingdom, I don't know about Poland, is that the curriculum in primary and secondary education is more and more being determined by central government, as already been mentioned. And that policy for education at primary and secondary education can often be determined by infighting within morally corrupt political parties and having then an effect on how our children are educated. I believe that our universities should be the source of our moral purpose. If universities are not, what is? We don't believe the church anymore. We don't believe politicians. Policemen in my country are no longer believed. Judges can't speak. Where does moral purpose come from if it is not from the university? But in order for that to occur, universities have to be independent of government and intellectually free. For the last 1,000 years, I believe the history of thought around the world has been the transmission of European idea, except possibly to Japan before the Jesuits arrived, and also to China. And if we go back to the 13th century, Paris University, par excellence to me, was the concept that the university should be. It was trying to define a noble purpose by intense debate, by analysis of what the world was, in freedom. Of course, that was within a structure of the church at that time. And for the last 1,000 years, that spirit of Paris University has come down to us through Hegel and Descartes and the Industrial Revolution and the scientific revolution of the 19th and 20th century, mostly from universities. I don't believe, Mateusz, that universities are primarily about doing something for society. I do not believe, Chris, that universities are primarily to help the economy of the country. I believe that they are primarily to engender a noble purpose in individuals and educare, lead out from the individual the potential for internal fulfillment. But we have a problem in that. Many of our universities have been driven to become corporate businesses. I went to my own university leadership. Don't tell them this, Chris, will you?
It's all right, I won't.
And with a novel project, I was told the first thing we had to do was to analyze reputational risk. The second was not to, we had to manage the expectations of professors. And thirdly, consult the lawyers. And what I wanted was, is this a novel creative idea or not? And most universities are driven to become businesses, and I've got a solution to that at the end of my talk. Secondly, education in university, the government believes, is to produce bricks in the economic wall. And there is a lacking of an underpinning philosophy in what the university should be doing. Now, I think that underpinning philosophy should primarily come if we are to engender a noble purpose in our society, so that we can understand who we are as Europeans, so that we can have cohesion against the Russian threat, for example. Or we can develop a new moral European society that will be world-leading, then the underpinning philosophy has not got to be based primarily in the nature of society, but primarily in the nature of the individual human being. And I think that that's what Anna Palacio was saying was lacking. Secondarily, there has to be an analysis of what society is, and then the individual applied to that. And I think we have got that completely wrong in what we're doing in universities. Individuals are not coming first. The needs of society are coming first, as you heard all the speakers before me say. So I believe the individual destiny of each one of us is not primarily to be found in increasing economic growth forever, but is to be found in internal fulfillment through arts, theatre, literature, debate, music. And that, placed in a European context, is what will give us our European noble purpose and distinguish us from the rest of the world. I'm not saying the rest of the world is wrong in any way. It is very different. And I believe that the difference of the European noble purpose are what we need here in Europe at this moment. And I think that this can apply to anybody. I come from Yorkshire in the north of England, where coal miners have the most wonderful brass bands, and they get together in the evenings to play Mozart. They have been educated to bring out of them the potential to play wonderful music and so fulfill themselves. And to me, that is one example of 5 minutes, one example of how universities should be behaving. We're not funding humanities, as Norman said, as we should. the Department of Philosophy in my university is run on less than my travel budget in the Division of Medicine. Now, isn't that tragic in our values? I think that we should be teaching European values within our universities, European heritage, history, and we should be more supportive of having a faith in the cultural nature of what we are. There's also been a more subtle shift, both in society in general and in teaching. We're moving away from qualitative thought to quantitative thought. We're losing the ability to make judgments related to idea and value idea, and moving towards valuing quantification and measurement for its own sake. This is manifest, for example, in my own promotion. I've got to go through a thing called the research evaluation assessment by the government. The government scores me on 4 publications. I get a score from 1 to 4 or 4-star, and the box is ticked, money is given to my department. There is nobody with wisdom judging me about how I'm going to perform over the next 5 years. It's a quantitative judgment about my last 5 years. I've just been appraised as a doctor. I filled in a 100-page form, each section of it quantifiable. What we need is more wisdom in universities. I think that subtle shift is manifested throughout society. Even in medicine, my young doctors have lost the ability to make diagnoses, which is an abstract qualitative concept. They want to simply measure numbers related to changes in the body and make them better. I think also there's been a spiritual brutalization in our education from the age of 10 upwards. In my own field, which is medicine, applicants to go into medical school have got to study molecular biology from the age of 13. They've got to measure very, very small events. They don't think about systems. These small events are analogous to the economic units that the government is asking us to produce. Young scientists, when I get them, cannot think in systems. We've lost the ability to do physiology. We can only measure things. This is reflected in the way we fund research in the university. We're asked to do small, low-risk experiments and not take big, high-risk experimental efforts. When I went to my dean, I asked if I could arrange for medical students to paint a picture in the Slade School of Art as part of their education, to face a blank canvas with some oil on a stick and have to do something with it. And I thought that that would be wonderful for their education as doctors. I was told yes, only if the amount of time, 2 weeks, is added to the end of their course, otherwise they can't do it. However, there are successes. I'm also a professor in Yale, and I organize a thing called the Yale-UCL Medical Students Poetry Competition, where there was a £1,000 prize every year for 5 years, and golly, over 5 years we've had more than 500 poems, often of very high quality, written by medical students. And that's the sort of change I want throughout the university, from quantitative thinking to qualitative thinking. Yale has an independent endowment of $28 billion that funds the university, that funds many aspects of it, its social aspects, admitting poor students, allowing it to be free from government support. I believe that we need that sort of financial freedom if we're going to have proper university education where we value humanities. So the solution then is, number one, I think, to motivate professors to take part in the politics of education. And as Chris said, it's surprising here at the Vossoff Forum, there's no educational element. I noticed that Professor Sims in Cambridge tried to establish a political party arising out of universities. That we have to preach economic growth secondary to human fulfillment. And we need funding independent of government. And I think we can do that. I raised £120 million in 1997 based upon two patents that I had got from my research in university. I've recently raised £28.5 million on three patents of my inventions from university. The problem is, panel, the problem is that most professors and most students in sciences don't understand what a patent is. That is the same throughout the whole of Europe. Our universities are throwing away billions upon billions of euros worth of value in what could be exploited out of inventions from universities and used to fund universities. And my dream is that science inventions through exploitation of intellectual property should be a source of funding for the humanities. And that, Norman, is my big idea. But I believe it is 5 to midnight. I believe that European education in universities, particularly also in secondary school, is nearly lost. We are nearly at the end. Because a shift towards achieving economic goals in education, a shift away from the humanities to sciences, a shift from qualitative thinking to qualitative thinking. We should be having seminars in what is our noble purpose and not on the latest discovery in science. Thank you. So, Chris, you're relieved. I am back as chairman now. There were lots of ideas from our four speakers, including me, some of them contradictory. I think all of us thinking that there was a major problem. Anybody like to make any comments from the floor or ask any questions about anything in the world, including your heart attacks, I'm a cardiologist, about anything at all to any of us here? Somebody going to put a hand up there? The first question.
Questions.
Gentleman over there. Could you say who you are, please?
Piotr Grodziński.
Yes, we can hear you, yes.
Piotr Grodziński, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Sometimes back I was... somehow connected to political philosophy. I must say that I have a real problem with the Nobel purpose thesis as the main goal for academia or for formal education. And here I have a three sequence of thoughts. First, my generation is a generation which have the experience of ideology, which means that the schooling system was used to create a certain concept of values that were deemed to be the noble purpose, but were not noble purpose. Well, I won't expand. It's obvious, the problem is not. When I think in my life experience, I belong to a generation which one can say is the generation of Solidarność. I was 30 years old when Solidarność exploded. And I had the feeling that at that moment I belonged to a 10 million large group of people which had a common noble purpose. But this did not sprang from the academic education. Perhaps it was somehow educated by culture at large, but not in a formal way. At the same time, I feel that the present forum and the topic of this event is an interesting signal that we are perhaps at the moment in the history where we have to rethink and instead of thinking in terms of Raymond Aron, Popper, well, all those group of thinkers which were against ideology, there is a need of ideology. But I'm not quite sure, and this need of ideology seems to me obvious when we observe the Maidan effects, the Maidan events, and identify ourselves with those people there. So there's a feeling that we should find something like this.
But thank you very much.
I'll finish. Okay. My feeling is that the purpose of academia is to open horizon, to show the different, the big world, and to give instrument to navigate in this big world. But I'm not sure the value system is what should be done. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that's a very important comment. My belief is we all do need a noble purpose. As a doctor, within my marriage, within my society, I think if it's based, if the purpose is based upon Marx and Engels, it's not a good purpose. If it's based upon Aristotle and Aquinas, perhaps it's different. How do I know? I can't measure it. It's a qualitative, not a quantitative judgment. Okay. All right, but well said. Any of you would like to comment on that? Chris? Go
ahead. Well, just to begin with the idea of noble purpose, absolutely clearly the case that education is defined by trying to do something for others. It is by definition, teachers at whatever level motivated by achieving something for others. I think Mateusz made the pretty controversial point that the education systems of the Eastern Europe before 1989, for all their many faults, had one achievement, which was to get to a pretty good basic level of education for a very large number. And I think one of the tensions that runs around in Western education is the tension between elite and mass education. That plays out, I think, in slightly different ways in schools, in colleges, in kindergarten. In terms of what education's for, which we ditched, I fall back on a very old joke, which goes like this. Education is what you remember when you've forgotten what you learned. And actually, although it's a joke, there's something there, which is that there is another old joke, which I'll end with in a moment, which is that for all the information and the facts and the theories and the ideas, that which is left in terms of the experience frequently defines education. The other joke which I always end up with is that you learn the three most important things you'll ever learn in kindergarten. You learn to say thank you, you learn to line up, and you learn to flush.
Norman?
I was wondering about the potential argument between education for society and education for individuals. I feel that distinction is a false one. Society is made up of individuals. If you have well-educated, purposefully educated individuals, you have a healthy society. So I don't think it's one or the other. It's both. And they're very intimately intertwined.
I agree, Norman, and there is this tension between Marxist approach, where society calls the individual, or what you just said, yes, the Western Christian approach, yeah, where the individual causes society. Yeah. Yeah. Mateusz, do you want to say something about noble purpose?
Just a quick remark on what we've been discussing for 5 minutes. I think that in as much as obviously there's a some people might agree that it's a false distinction between education for society and education for the individuals. I think that there's one more false distinction that we have heard or we sort of rely on in our thinking about education is, and that touches upon largely the whole process of determining the process or reflecting the processes of society, is that you've mentioned the key word here, which is formal education. And that's something that we haven't really discussed much, and I regret to say that I haven't mentioned myself, is that we tend to think of education in terms of institution. We think of education as a process that has been given to a candidate in schools or universities or other academic institutions and so on and so forth. Whereas there is a large part of what an individual and then subsequently what a society of individuals should be told, which falls outside the basic notions of what one is being told in primary, secondary or high school. And there is a huge, huge role to play for the informal education, which is not necessarily to be taking place all in schools. And I think one issue, if I might just conclude, one issue that we need to take into consideration is that we tend, parallel to the whole process of centralization and of having massive central institutions located in our governments that tend to decide on curriculums and every single kid in the country or in the wider region, I think we tend to somehow overburden our institutions with what we expect from the school to provide our kids with. And I'm seeing that, even speaking past my own experience, because both my parents are teachers, and I see progressively every year after year they told not just to teach mathematics and English and Italian, but they also told to replace the role of the parents in school. And there's a huge role to play for the informal education, which is outside school. Oftentimes, it is on the playground, it is on the bus, and so on and so forth. So let's not overburden the institutions.
I agree. We're bringing up lots of questions and problems. I'm not hearing many solutions, apart from I put forward two. One is professors should get involved in politics. The other is we should raise money from university science. So think about solutions to the problem before we come to the end. Now, another question. A man there in a shirt.
Hopefully, yes.
Yes. And just introduce yourself, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Yuri Umchuk, and I'm a student of Wroclaw University of Economics. And I have a question considering teachers. As from my personal experience, what I had, a lot of teachers do not consider their students as friends or as a student. We are both like just people coming by their classes, sitting there and listening to their thoughts. Because of that, we're not learning this subject as we would learn. Teacher is not acting, is not interrupting with us, is not talking to us. We're not exchanging thoughts. And this, and I'm talking about European kind of model of education. Yes. So what is wrong with it, and what could be done to change it?
I think that's a super question. And I'm very concerned about what you say if we go into digital learning, when your problem will be even worse when you're sitting in front of a computer screen with a different teacher. So who'd like to say something about that? How do we interact and look our students in the eye? Which one of you wants to say something?
Well, I'll go first again, if filling the gap. there's pretty strong evidence right the way across the world. The research evidence is consistent that it is teachers which make the difference to pupil outcomes. Of all the in-school influences on achievement, teachers are the most important. The most successful school systems, looking at Shanghai, looking at Singapore, looking at Finland, are those which have invested most extensively in recruiting, retaining, and developing high-quality teachers. What is it that constitutes high-quality teaching? It is a combination of subject knowledge, of pedagogic content, and personal commitment skills. That's what we know. It's a very simple lesson. There are very few replicable lessons in education research. That's one of them.
But can I just challenge you on that?
You can, yes.
Because you said successful, the success of Shanghai. As far as I'm concerned, they're not developing individuals. They're not having a tutorial system.
Okay.
They are getting good results in maths exams. And is that what education is about?
So I'll challenge back. It is not the totality of education, but it is a part of what constitutes education. And if you look at what's happening in the Shanghai school system, they are now pretty clearly aware that the model that has taken them to those high test results is not the model that's taken them forward, and they're looking very openly across the world as to where they go next. It's not the total, but I think it does matter. Yeah.
So we do agree that person-to-person interaction is very important.
Well, person-to-person interaction, the other really interesting thing, and it's something that hugely irritates technologists and economists, is that for all the vast investment, billions of dollars in education technology over the last 35 years, nowhere in the world has broken the basic model of a teacher in a classroom with a pretty standard number of learners. It's really interesting. There's a very interesting question about whether we've got value for money out of technology.
Okay. Norman, you want to say something?
I heard the phrase tutorial system, which is very relevant. We've at least two people here from Oxford, but in Britain we know what it's about very much. I'm not certain that in Poland, it's as widespread, but the I've not done any research on this, but from my own experience, the richest learning experiences have been through close contact with high quality teachers, which I was very fortunate in having both at school and at university. One of the principles of teaching at Oxford and Cambridge is that students meet every week face to face, sometimes two students to one professor, sometimes one to one, as was my case. And the benefit for a young person to be in contact with somebody who has a noble purpose and great great knowledge is unparalleled. And we've always contrasted that with the poor experience, which I thought was echoed in what the gentleman said about his experience, of masses of students being processed by teachers who are not particularly interested, their numbers who, as it were, pass through their rooms, and students in such numbers that no teacher can possibly devote quality time to them.
Yeah.
And Could I just say about Poland? I think Poland has a very particular problem now in that university education expanded enormously over the, mm-hmm. the last 20 years. Some of the universities I know have four or five times as many students as they had 20 years ago. And there's no way that the teaching staff everywhere can be have been brought up to the same standard.
Okay. So, Norman, can I just ask the audience, when you're in university, how many of you put your hand up if you were involved in a tutorial system where one student met one professor, or two students met one professor? Hands up.
Ask them where.
Hands up. Okay, so quite a few of you. Are you all Polish to put your hands up? Yes. Okay, so the tutorial system does exist in Poland.
No, there may be a Pole who's been educated in Harvard, I think.
Maybe in Harvard. Okay, is there another question? So we have two, this woman at the front here, and then the last question up there, and then we'll finish, okay? Let's try and keep it short, because we've been going an hour and a half. And just introduce yourself, please.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Ashley Van Buskirk, and I'm with the Alliance for Innovation and Infrastructure from the U.S., my question for you is, how is the European education system preparing students for the digital economy? Not digital education.
For the digital economy?
Yes.
Okay, who wants to answer that? Mateusz?
I feel like I'm being called up to answer that question just because the whole digital, the big D word has been picked up on for quite some time in that debate. I think, and that again, given that I apparently have been given the role to be the controversial one in that debate. I don't think it is preparing for the digital economy, because as we've heard in the digital economy panel this morning, we differ in what we understand as the digital economy here in Europe and what the US seems to be understanding as the digital economy. And I think that I don't see any particular process in which European education, speaking as a whole, broadly, will be preparing it, because...
Okay, thank you. Your answer is we're not.
We're not.
Okay, good. not the lady there in the white, the person behind, yes, that
thank
chap.
You. You've said that you've raised millions of money, millions of euros by creating patents, but how could a social science faculty raise money?
That was not my point. My point was science faculties who do experiments at the bench and engineering faculties are inventing very important things all the time that could be patented and are very valuable, but they publish them and there's no chance of patentability. If we took the whole of that under control, I believe we could make billions of income for university, and then it could be that money could be funded by a trust in the university for social science and philosophy and literature and law. Okay? That's my point. So,
wouldn't that imply that universities would want more natural scientists than social scientists?
No, I think that there is a capacity in present natural science that hasn't been tapped. There would be a balance. The lady there.
Karolina Matusewicz, journalist from Radio Rodzina. I would like to ask about a role of Catholic school in nowadays. Isn't it too marginalized in nowadays? Should we come back to roots?
Thank you very much. I won't answer that. I was educated in a Catholic grammar school in England, which is rare in my country, but I'm going to ask Norman to answer that.
Oh dear, I'm not not too well informed on all this. It strikes me whenever I look at Polish schools today, what an enormous influence the Catholic Church has, far greater than was the case even before the war. and far greater than in other countries of Europe that I know. And I'm not too certain that it's very beneficial to confuse religious teaching with education in general.
Okay, thank you. Chris?
I think I can, with a bit of cleverness, connect up your question and the digital economy question. I don't think it matters. John said he went to a Catholic school in England. One of the things we've learned, it doesn't matter who runs the schools, it matters quite a lot what the schools do. I think that's really important. And the question I would push back to Catholic or any other church group running schools is, what are you doing about those four things that I said were really important? Education for all, education for innovation, education for cohesion, education for global citizenship. I'm less worried about who runs schools than what they do. And my response on digital economy is slightly different from John's, because Mateusz, which is that actually quite a lot of the skills for the digital economy turn out to be not at all dissimilar to the skills that we've needed over the last 40 or 50 years. It's being able to communicate effectively, to work with others, to think inventively, and those skills for digital economy often turn on some quite well-embedded approaches already in the school system.
I think your question might also apply to Islamic schools.
Absolutely.
Western Europe. Mateusz?
Just briefly, and I think, again, I'll try to replicate what you, Jun, did, and somehow interconnect the question that the gentleman asked about the tutorial system and the one-on-one, and the one-on-one system with your question about the role of Catholic schools. And I think, first of all, I fully agree with that statement that it doesn't matter who runs the school, it matters what the school provides you as a pupil with, in terms of skill set. But I don't think, first of all, that actually, if we're speaking about Poland, the Catholic schooling, and by saying Catholic schooling, I don't mean just Catholic schools as units, but I mean Catholic schooling as a notion, is being this much marginalized in comparison to what is happening in many other European countries. So I generally have some, honestly say, troubles with thinking in terms of how this could be improved. But in all sense, I agree that it's perhaps one advantage that actually Catholic schools in practical terms have over public schools here is that they tend to be much smaller in size, which then gives you an advantage of having more one-on-one contact, which we, as Professor Davis said rightly, have a terrible, terrible problem with in Poland, because we have oversized classes, we don't have enough teachers, yet we have way too many teaching hours. And then it leads to something that Klaus Bachmann from the Wroclaw University of Social Psychology said, that it ends up with teachers pretending to teach and students pretending to learn.
Thank you. I think some of the best schools in certainly in France are Jesuit schools in Paris, and they operate in a secular system where they are not allowed to teach religion per se and the Camino crucifixes. And I think that coming back to your question as a journalist, if Poland could approach that, where there's a good morality, a high intellectual standard within a secular environment, it would be super. Okay, so listen, we've been going now for 1 hour and 40 minutes. I think we'll get tired if we go any further. What I'm going to do is to ask each of our panelists just to say less than one paragraph about the European education system fit for purpose or not. And also, I haven't heard lots of complaints, but not many solutions. So if you could end on a solution, each one of you. Mateusz, do you want to start?
I don't think the European education is at the moment fit for purpose, but I'm very hopeful that it will be, and we'll find a way, because we've always had.
I'm more optimistic. I don't think it's unfit for purpose because I'm an academic. I spent 8 years before I became a higher education academic as a school teacher in urban comprehensive schools, and I learned from that the thing that fundamentally makes schools and systems fit for purpose or not is teachers, and I've learned over the last 30 years to trust teachers.
So, Norman, I'm leaving you to last. I'm going to go. Let me go before you.
So. All right.
So I believe that European education is broken, particularly at the university level, that it is not giving us a noble purpose in our lives as Europeans. And I think mostly it's because universities have become businesses and not organs of creating novel thought for the future.
I was slightly surprised that we seem to agree on so many things. In fact, I wondered whether there was going to be a debate at all. I'm not, in the end, a pessimist. If you talk about these things structurally and systematically, things are not as they should be. But somehow, I think educators overcome all the problems that they face. And I owe a great deal to the teachers that I was fortunate to meet. And I'm pretty certain out there are other excellent teachers who, in spite of all these problems and shortcomings, they will overcome the obstacles.
Okay, so I'm going to close now by, first of all, thanking all of you for being here on a Saturday afternoon. I think it's been really stimulating. I think we have not even started to address the problem. The problem of your tutorials is very, very important. The problem, sir, of your question is very important about noble purpose. What is it, and do we need it, and could we, in fact, be misled by it? The problem of Catholic schools is very important. So thank you, everybody. And I want to finish by thanking Norman Davies for coming here when he's really feeling quite ill. I know I'm a doctor, and he's said that I can tell he's not going to die. I promise that. And he'll be very well within a few days. But Norman, thank you very much for coming.
Well done, John.
Thank you. Thank you. I think, can we be heard?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can. Thank
you all. Is the mic switched off? No.
Thank you.